blood is in the air. So, we thought with the change in seasons, it was a good time to cover nosebleeds. Nosebleeds are extremely common, but are on the short list of things that really freak parents out. To see fresh blood pouring from your child's face, in any form, is incredibly disturbing. But not to be able to locate the original source, which is deep inside the mysterious cave that is a nostril, is even more horrifying.
From high above Caesar Rodney Square, we are the Podcast Pediatricians. I'm Rob Walter.
And I'm Matt Gotthold.
But before we get started, let's remind our listeners, we can be found on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, TuneIn, and now also on YouTube, although I've only got 5 or 6 episodes in, but we'll get all of them up there. And you can like us on Facebook. And if you like this podcast, if you like what we're doing, please tell a friend about it and have them subscribe and download. And join our mailing list on podcastpediatricians.com for bonus material and weird pictures and extensive bibliography for every episode.
And now our disclaimer. We are sharing our own personal opinions on pediatric care. Always talk to your own pediatric caregiver about your child. Pediatric caregivers should always consult expert guidelines and consider their own community's standards of care. So let's set the stage before we go nostril spelunking. Statistically, up to 14% of children have had a nosebleed this year, and about 10% of those affected will seek medical care. Approximately 1 in every 200 visits to the emergency room is for a nosebleed. These tend to occur in the young, particularly in children less than 10, and in the old, particularly in adults between 70 and 79 years old. More of these episodes occur in winter than in any other season. Nosebleeds are actually not very common in children who are under 2, but instead peak between the ages of 3 and 8, and they are more common in boys. Did you ever get nosebleeds, Rob? You know, aside from all those times you got punched in the face by classmates who failed to understand your sophisticated sense of humor.
Okay, first, yes, I had terrible allergies as a kid, back when allergy shots were useless and the meds were no better than placebos. But I love the taste of Crisidin or Coricidin, whatever it was. I love the taste of it. So most of my nosebleeds happened when I was sleeping overnight. I'd wake up in the morning with dried blood all over my face and all over the pillow. It was like a frickin' Tarantino movie scene every morning. And yes, I did get punched in the face twice, both times in Hebrew school, in front of Hebrew school, once by a local thug named Gerald and once by my best friend Evan. All this is unavoidable on the mean streets of Syosset. You just don't understand what it was like growing up on those mean streets of Syosset, Long Island.
Nice. It's funny that you got punched by your best friend, because I actually, the only fist fight I can distinctly remember, although I think there were more than that one, was when one of my best friends, Bobby Minnick, and I had a fight, and I punched him in the face and a tooth flew out. Now, I thought this was particularly disturbing. He ran home and with the tooth lying in the mud, and I ran home and cried and feared that I had done permanent damage to my friend. You know, little did we know, that was the time your tooth was supposed to fall out anyway. It was a big moment in my life.
Evidently it was.
Yes. Sorry, Bobby.
Bobby never made it out of the South Jersey Pinelands anyway, so.
Come on. Before we get too much further, it's time for some basic nasal anatomy and physiology. The nose, like many other parts of the human body, is a fascinating structure with multiple functions. It serves to clean, warm, and humidify air as it's inhaled through its passages, and also permits us to smell, and it assists us in taste. It consists of two primary passages, the right and the left nostrils, which are separated by a middle structure known as the septum. Each nostril has shelves that protrude into it. You can almost imagine them as if they're bookshelves protruding into it, which are bony and are called turbinates. These structures increase the surface area within the nose. Ingeniously, they've been named the inferior, middle, and superior turbinates.
So, Matt, you know about the nasal cycle?
The nasal cycle?
The nasal cycle.
Tell me. I think I do, but go ahead.
It's not like a spin thing.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, we all normally have alternate breathing from one nostril to the other every 2 to 4 hours. It changes back and forth. And this is controlled by our autonomic nervous system and was first described in ancient yoga literature. Not Yogi. Wow. Not Yogi Bear. It seems to help your breathing and sense of smell and taste. And this cycle can all get all messed up when you have things like a deviated septum or nasal congestion. So when a teen is worried that he only uses one nostril at a time to breathe, and I've had kids, teens say to me, I'm worried because only one nostril seems to work at a time. As long as it alternates sides and isn't just one nostril always, tell them it's normal.
Wow. Isn't there a certain yoga pose or a set of poses where you actually occlude your nostril with your thumb? Do you think that has anything to do with it?
I would have no idea.
Yeah.
Nor am I really interested.
Google it.
Okay.
Anyway, attached to the nasal passages are the sinuses, like the side streets, cul-de-sacs, more or less. This set of paired chambers, in their healthy state, contains mostly air. The purpose of sinuses has been debated over the years, but those who study functional anatomy feel that at least one purpose is to make the skull lighter.
And you have a really heavy skull.
Unfortunately, you have a very light skull. The nasal cavity is separated from the inside of the mouth by the palate, which is the roof of the mouth, and leads into your throat. And the throat goes past the vocal cords and into the trachea, and then into the lungs. The nasal passages and sinuses are lined with tiny hairs called cilia. And cilia in Latin, by the way, Rob, means eyelash.
Mm.
A human nose produces up to 2 quarts of mucus per day.
Which is why you need that spit boy, remember?
Exactly.
From last season?
And this mucus is moved along by the cilia in waves, helping to whisk away dust and other foreign particles. So it kind of works the way a crowd does at a concert where the lead singer is kind of crowd surfing. That's the way that the mucus blanket works.
Back in 1983 when lead singers did that.
Oh, come on. Okay. As this mucus blanket is eventually moved toward the back of the throat, it's swallowed. We all do this all day long, generally not realizing that it's part of our existence.
And this is just like the earwax blanket that is slowly pushed out of from your eardrum every day by your ear canal cilia. Everything always gets back to earwax.
For Rob, all roads lead to earwax.
Do you remember the genetic disease that causes these cilia not to work? It's called immotile cilia syndrome or Cartagener syndrome, where this mucus blanket cannot be moved away, leading to pneumonias, sinusitis, ear infections, and even sterility because the sperm can't move well either, and the eggs can't be pushed along the fallopian tube. Cartagener syndrome. Remember that from the boards?
I do. As the air we breathe comes in through the nose, it passes over highly specialized cells which permit us to smell, located in the roof part of the nose. Incredibly, our brain can recognize and identify a nearly infinite number of subtle smells. The human nose has roughly 400 types of scent receptors that can detect at least a trillion different odors. This system also permits us to identify tastes, which are more idiosyncratic than the tongue's taste buds' abilities. And if you remember, Rob, the tongue can identify sweet, sour, bitter, salty, and my personal favorite, umami, which means savory.
Oh, I love that. Now, Matt, do you like the new baby smell? Do you know what that is?
The smell of new babies?
Yes.
Yeah, it's kind of like a fleshy, newish smell,
well,
isn't it?
Mm-hmm. I really didn't. Someone told me. I didn't really know this was a thing, but evidently there is a sweet, pleasing smell on new babies, and part of it may be vernix added to it that lasts for about 6 weeks that seems to really help the bonding between parents and their newborns. And last week on Rounds, when I read about this, I thought, well, let me just check this out. Well, I was thinking of smelling the baby, but that seemed really weird because you do it in front of the parents.
Oh, I've been known to smell many babies.
I couldn't do it. I couldn't, like, let me just smell your baby. So, but anyway, it's a thing.
I think if you ask politely.
Maybe.
Our noses are very sensitive to the variety of different assaults thrown at us by the environment. These include viruses, bacteria, and other germs, allergens, and other environmental irritants. All of these factors can result in inflammation of the sensitive nasal passages, which are lined by mucosa. Of course, all this wonderfulness needs a blood supply. This originates in the internal and external carotid arteries. Nosebleeds, or the fancy term, epistaxis, are generally classified as either anterior or posterior, based on the location of the blood vessels that are the source of the bleeding. Anterior epistaxis, from the part of the nose that's closest to the tip, is responsible for over 90% of nosebleeds in children. Kesselbach's plexus is the primary source. Who is Kesselbach's plexus named after, Rob?
I assume a Dr. Kesselbach, who was some kind of a nose doctor who's probably dead.
And indeed, you are right on
bing,
all
bing,
counts.
Bing, bing, bing,
bing. Bing, bing, bing. And we have a winner. Kesselbach's plexus is named after Wilhelm Kesselbach, a German otolaryngologist who published a paper on the area in 1884. However, James Little, an American surgeon, first described the area in 1879. Ooh. So I don't know. Sounds like a little intellectual property theft there. What do you think?
Okay, Matt, you can call it Little's plexus.
This complex of blood vessels is in the anterior part, or the front part, of the nasal septum, just about a quarter of a centimeter from the tip of the nose. It has a very rich blood supply under a very thin surface layer, or mucosa. I always tell parents that if they look at the palm side of the wrist and see how close the blood vessels are there, that the vessels just inside the nose are that close or closer to the surface.
I like that. I'm going to start saying that and then just describing that some kids, and we see them, just have naturally the vessels close to the surface and are more prone to these nosebleeds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and as one can imagine, this area is the most exposed to the environment, including any type of trauma or dry air. Almost all the bleeding that is generated from this area exits through the nostrils. These types of nosebleeds are much easier to see and control than posterior nosebleeds.
Yeah, posterior nosebleeds are really, really scary.
There you are, nasty business. Anyway, in posterior epistaxis, or posterior bleeding, Woodruff's plexus is the source. Who is Woodruff's plexus named after, Rob?
Dr. Woodruff, dead.
Dead. Bleeding from this area mostly flows into the back of the throat and the mouth, making the degree of bleeding very difficult to evaluate. This type of bleeding is usually much more voluminous than anterior bleeding. Due to this, it's much more likely than anterior bleeding to lead to an issue of blood loss. For our purposes, though, we will concentrate on anterior bleeding today. So, Rob?
Yes.
First sidebar. Do you know where the term nosy comes from?
No.
Okay, so presumably the term nosy was applied to Matthew Parker, an English clergyman who was alive between 1504 and 1575. The term entered the lexicon to mean someone who pokes his nose into other people's business. Now, Parker was the Archbishop of Canterbury under Queen Elizabeth I. Even though he was considered to be kind of shy and modest, he was also considered to be overly inquisitive about church matters, and his enemies began to call him Nosy Parker. Some sources debate this, but history can be fickle.
Are there pictures of Matthew Parker? Because I just would assume
there are pictures of Matthew Parker. I Wikipedia'd him.
It's very possible that he just had a huge Jimmy Durante type schnoz,
big old proboscis.
Yes. Now, do you know Jimmy Durante?
I do.
Oh. I know my Bubby's favorite performer. You know Inka Dinka?
I know of it.
Inka Dinka Dink, Inka Dinka Dink. Ga-ding-ga-doo. It's got the whole world spooning. Now, I don't know if that's spooning
what?
That we talk about.
Really?
Spooning, I looked up the lyrics.
It's a little risky for, what was that, like 1920s or
30s,
so? Yeah. I was actually going to ask you to name some famous noses, and you just named one of them.
Cyrano de Bergerac
is the other. Yes. Didn't Steve Martin do kind of like a modern take on that?
I think it was Roxanne.
Yeah. Steve Martin, genius. Steve Martin, polymath. Steve Martin, Renaissance man. But history, as always, is essential for the treatment and diagnosis of this condition, so that's what we're going to concentrate on now. As with all other medical conditions, the evaluation should start with a very careful history, followed by a physical exam. With nosebleeds, the season and the associated environmental conditions are extremely important. One also needs to ask about any trauma, and particularly about nose picking, which the child will generally deny and the parent will generally report. This can lead to an amusing debate in the office, which sometimes needs to be ended by the pediatrician saying, okay, it's time to move on.
Okay, but wait, I said this last season, but I got to say this again. When this comes up, you always ask the kid which finger they use to pick their own nose and hold up your own index finger slowly. Even teens will slowly raise their own finger when you ask that question. And then you say, ha. Trick question. The answer is I do not pick my nose. And then mom and I laugh.
Nice.
It's nice.
It's a nice little parlay.
And Matt,
don't
you
expect
know,
to ever see that kid in the office again.
You know, it gets through the day. Matt, do you know what rhinotelexomania is?
I believe, just by the by the breakdown there of the Latin or Greek or whatever the heck that is, that it means they have an obsession with picking their nose.
Exactly. Obsessive nose picking. It's a rare disorder, mostly in men, which is no big surprise, and it's part of the OCD spectrum and is not to be confused with the everyday frequent nose picking by men in their cars and while sitting on toilets.
How about that?
Good to know.
Yeah, all right. So, in addition to history of possible nose picking, there are other things here that matter. Is the bleeding only from one side? If so, there may be some type of a local anatomic abnormality. Is the bleeding from one side, and does the discharge smell really awful? This may well indicate a foreign body. At least half of the children in an emergency room for a possible foreign body will admit putting it there. So, even young children should be asked about this possibility. Rob, have you ever had the experience of walking into the room to see a patient who's there for chronic congestion and then been bowled over by the smell?
No.
Oh, I have. Now, it's only happened twice, but saw it on my schedule, nasal congestion, walked in the room. Whew!
Really?
Oh, yeah. Nastiness. And yeah. It was just this festering God knows what up there. I forget in that instance what it was, but oh, it's nasty business. Anyway, back to the history. Has there been a runny nose? If so, what's the character of the mucus? If it's clear and watery and associated with sneezing, then there's a good chance the child has allergies. If it's very thick and associated with a cough, this may suggest some sort of an upper respiratory infection.
Next, how long has the nosebleed been going on? If this is a truly chronic problem, perhaps there is some type of an inherited cause. Has there been any easy bruising? Or does the child's skin exam demonstrate any petechiae, which are tiny little non-blanching blood spots that don't turn white when you press on them? Has the child had problems with excessive bleeding in the past, for instance, when they've skinned their knee or have had some type of routine surgical procedure, like a circumcision? This type of history may indicate some type of bleeding disorder, although a child with hemophilia can have an uneventful circumcision, and most babies who have a lot of bleeding with a circumcision don't have a clotting problem. Is there an associated fever or excessive paleness? If so, then the examiner must think of things like leukemia. Is there any family history of bleeding symptoms or of anyone who has been diagnosed with a bleeding disorder?
Is there a history of migraine headache? One study a short time ago revealed an association between migraine headaches and recurring nosebleeds, suggesting some type of common thread.
I did not know that, although it makes some kind of sense since migraines are thought to be somewhat of a vascular phenomenon.
Yeah, it does. And the other thing that I think needs to be addressed here is despite the fact that we always wonder about somebody's blood pressure, you know, when they have a nosebleed, and put that together sometimes with a headache, this is very, very uncommon. You know, in fact, essentially unheard of from the research that I did.
Really? Although I have to say, if the chief complaint is nosebleed, I tell the nurses, always, always check a blood pressure.
You betcha. All right. Next, the child needs to be examined. Blood pressure and pulse should be taken if the history involves significant blood loss. The nose should be examined carefully. An attempt should be made to identify the source of any bleeding and to notice the characteristics of the nasal mucosa and of any discharge.
And again, looking at that interior septum for dried blood or prominent vessels, make sure that no blood is coming from the posterior part of the nasal opening. Do you routinely use a nasal speculum, Matt?
You know, we have them in our drawers, and I can't remember the last time I used one.
Me too.
Not very often.
I have it, but I usually with my otoscope, and then sometimes even using the ear speculum with it if I need to.
Right.
I feel like I can get a very good nasal exam if the child's cooperative.
Yep. The examiner should look for any type of obstructing mass or foreign body. The child's neck needs to be examined for the presence of any unusual mass or an excessive number or size of lymph nodes. The skin needs to be checked for the previously mentioned issues of petechiae and or bruising. Overall, a full exam is probably the best way to go here to check for any evidence of unusual findings, including excessive lymphadenopathy or an enlarged liver or spleen, which in the biz we call hepatosplenomegaly.
That's a good point. For many presenting complaints, it is not good enough to just look at an ear for ear pain or just look at the nose for nosebleeds. You really need to look at the whole child, which is difficult to do in telemedicine, and to get, you know, to pick up things that are unexpected.
Rob, I agree with you 1,000% on this one. In fact, if somebody comes to me for something trivial like, you know, a mole or something else that they really just want a yes or no answer on, I make sure I start with a more thorough exam, working my way toward that singular complaint that to me is usually not a big issue. But it gives me an opportunity to examine a child, which is never a bad idea for a pediatrician when they're in your office.
Absolutely. And sometimes you pick up a surprise.
Mm-hmm.
And you should document it. If you did it, you should document it.
You betcha. So now that the history has been taken and the exam has been done, what are the possibilities? Well, oftentimes there are several things at play here. Trauma from picking or rubbing a nose will generally account for the majority of cases of nosebleeds in children, especially when this is done at the same time there is already some inflammation present from an upper respiratory infection or from allergy.
And as I always say, you can pick your friends and you can pick your nose, but you can't pick your friend's nose.
I knew you would somehow work that in here.
Thank you, Dave Gahanek, for that. And although I do hear that in Jersey, they do pick their friends' noses.
Not in South Jersey, buddy. Of course, one must also think of trauma from a foreign body, particularly in toddlers. As we mentioned, this is sometimes associated with a very strong odor from the child's general vicinity. What are some of the things that you've retrieved from a patient's nose, Rob Walter?
Actually, nothing that exciting. Some beads, some styrofoam, some crayon bits, my light up Bionics earwax remover I've used, and it can help me sometimes get the foreign body out. One of the cool things also, as an aside, when you get them out, it's so fun to do, and you actually use the code for removing foreign bodies, mm-hmm. which are codes that mostly surgeons use, and it pays more than like 2 teenage well visits, which is crazy.
This is true. This is true.
We should have went into a procedure-oriented specialty, I think. We would not have had as much fun. But
One of the weirdest things I've ever pulled out of a nose was a lima bean. Now, it was relatively fresh and cooked. And, of course, it was in a toddler, so I couldn't convince them to occlude one side and blow hard. And it kind of broke up in pieces as I was doing this. And it was really quite the challenge. And the more I thought about it, if he was older, I would have said, like, hey, look, if you don't like lima beans, your nose is not the place to put them here, buddy. Yeah. Although I did wonder after that, if we just left it there, do you think it would have grown a lima bean plant? Stranger things have happened, right? Isn't that kind of what we did in grade school with the blotter paper and the jars?
Wait, I'm more interested in Matt as a physician.
Yes.
Do you really think about if a lima bean can grow out of his nose?
I think about all kinds of things I don't share with you. All right.
But, you know, the other thing we should mention is for an older kid has a foreign body up there and you're struggling, should you send him to ENT and such, mm-hmm. you know, have them include the other side nostril and blow.
Right.
And sometimes the Applejack, I did have an Applejack.
Okay. Right,
and the Applejack just shot out. And that's, you know, no muss, no fuss. But as with all foreign bodies anywhere, you have to be careful about doing harm. And if it's really stuck or really squirmy kid, send them to ENT. They have better toys to take them out, and they have more ability to sedate the child mm-hmm. to not do harm.
And they know how to code for the big bucks.
Right.
There you go.
I have to add, so the most famous case of nasal foramen bodies was in a boy named Jaime, as described by...
Do that again.
Jaime.
Nice.
As described by...
Did you get that in Hebrew school?
Yes, I did. As described by Cheech and Chong. Now, you know I am totally against legalizing recreational pot, but I do love my Cheech and Chong. So this is an ode to Cheech and Chong. So as Jaime's dad described this problem to his pediatrician using an accent like my grandfather or Nick Kroll, if you know Nick Kroll, everything goes up Jaime's nose. Up his nose it goes. A walnut, a peanut, a penny, a quarter, half dollar, silver dollar. He has Fort Knox up his nose. Trains and boats and planes up his nose. And last week, a whole bagel with lox and cream cheese.
I think I remember hearing that Cheech and Chong bit.
Someday I'm going to torture you with my Basketball Jones.
Oh.
Same album.
See, you didn't think I knew that.
I did not.
All right. So getting back to the topic. So this could well be a case of simple trauma, you know, if it's not a bagel in the nose. Kids are always bonking their noses on things and always getting their noses bonked by their peers. If there is indeed such a situation, then it may be necessary to evaluate the child for a nasal fracture or for an anterior septal hematoma. Nasal fractures are often not as dramatic as they may seem. Even with a demonstrated fracture on x-ray, unless the fracture is causing some type of a functional distortion, like not permitting the child to breathe through the nostril properly, or there is a major cosmetic impact, there's typically no reason to have it fixed. To determine if there's an issue with moving air through the nostril, the examiner simply occludes one side of the nostril, one nostril rather, by pressing it closed with his or her thumb in yoga-like fashion. The examiner simply occludes one side and then assesses the airflow through the other nostril and then repeats the same procedure for the other side. Unless, of course, you are Rob, who has been known to stick his thumb into the child's nostril, which apparently is what they do in Long Island.
Actually, I think that is the way young lovers in South Jersey show affection. It's their way of holding hands.
Nice. Oh, no, I'm getting this picture in my head now. A septal hematoma is essentially a walled-off collection of blood at the septum that, if left untreated, can lead to a decreased blood flow to that area and then a deterioration of the septum. I don't know about you, Rob, but I was trained not to routinely get x-rays of the nose unless there was a major distortion, like a skewing of the nose to one side or a denting in of the nose, or unless there was a lawsuit involved, frankly. If indeed there's a nasal fracture that needs to be fixed, ENTs will generally wait at least several days until the swelling has diminished.
Yes, yes, I agree, except when it's like a Rocky Balboa nose. Mm-hmm. If it's really, really misshapen, then that needs to be addressed very quickly. But
cut me, Mick!
That's different. But if it's a Marsha Brady nose, like getting hit by the football by Greg, that can wait.
Wait a minute. Oh, my nose! Oh, my nose! Oh, my nose! Did you see that with your friends?
It made a great gift, too.
Like, oh, no. You put your thumbnail under your front tooth, and you click it and go, oh, my nose.
No.
Oh, my nose.
Oh, that's awful.
Oh, my nose.
No.
That was Marsha. What kind of fun did you guys have?
With younger children, upper respiratory infections and allergies are oftentimes the setup for nosebleeds. If a child's nose is running or uncomfortable, it often leads to them picking at it or rubbing on it, or to forceful sneezing and nose blowing, which can also precipitate anterior nosebleeds. With inflammation, there is congestion of the blood vessels and a lot of irritation superficially, and this sets up nosebleeds. A simple, often overlooked environmental condition is an overall lack of humidity. This can cause the mucous membranes of the nose to dry out excessively and bleed. The use of humidifiers and vaporizers, again, not hot ones, we don't want people to trip over them and get burned, but cool or room air humidifiers and vaporizers, particularly next to the child who's sleeping, can assist greatly with this dilemma. As seasons change, we increasingly seem to move directly from air conditioning, which largely removes humidity from the air in our homes, to forced air heating, which also is drying to the environment and worsens croup also.
One also must not overlook anatomic differences, like a deviated septum. This type of situation can cause recurrent nosebleeds mainly by changing the normal flow of the air, which leads to excessive drying and irritation.
Yes, the deviated septum. While real sometimes, the mild phantom deviated septum has been the excuse for teens on Long Island and the Main Line to get nose jobs for generations.
Not in South Jersey, where men are men.
And noses are misshapen.
And noses are the way they came out. The purposeful inhalation of drugs, both legal and illegal, can certainly irritate the inside of the nose. It's not uncommon for us to prescribe saline spray for colds or nasal steroid sprays to children with allergies. If the nasal applicators are used incorrectly, this creates a trauma within an area that's already irritated by allergy. I'll usually demonstrate how to do this the right way by pointing the tip of the spray bottle toward the ear instead of toward the middle of the nose, where the septum and the famous Kesselbach plexus is. Of course, cocaine use and a variety of other drugs of abuse, including other stimulants, should be considered as well if there's significant irritation to the inside of the nose.
Have you ever seen a septal perforation?
Only when I was in medical school.
Yeah, I had one patient who was in college, had it from cocaine use. And it's nasty looking and requires significant reconstruction.
It surely does. Yeah, it's a miserable condition. Yeah. What about nasal masses or tumors? These are uncommon in children, but need to be considered, depending on the circumstances. Nasal polyps can be associated with cystic fibrosis. Other nasal masses, such as juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibromas, rhabdosarcomas, and nasal carcinomas are rare, but important to identify. Hemangiomas, most commonly seen on the outer skin as strawberry marks, are also a rare possibility because they can be within the nose as well.
And got to highlight that juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma, because it occurs in mostly boys around age 15, and it's benign, but because of its location, it can erode into nearby areas such as the ear, and it can bleed a ton and needs to be addressed. Back in my radiology days, we used to embolize it preoperatively before it was taken out, which is really cool. I haven't seen one since.
Well, you took care of them all during your residency, apparently. As we previously mentioned, the issue may be a much more systemic one. You know, it may involve the whole body and its systems. So bleeding disorders certainly need to come to a pediatrician's mind if nosebleeds are recurrent. These include hematologic disorders like platelets disorders, coagulation disorders, and overall low platelet counts. With low platelet counts, also known as thrombocytopenia, there's almost always some type of skin finding as well, like petechiae or bruising. A particular type of disorder, idiopathic thrombocytopenia purpura, can present as nosebleeds in up to 30% of patients who suffer from it. If a child is on a chronic medication, including some of the anti-seizure medications, this needs to be taken to account as well.
Unfortunately, leukemia needs to be considered, since this condition certainly disrupts the normal functioning and presence of blood cells and clotting. However, nosebleeds are very rarely the first symptom of leukemia. One must think of the leukemia possibility if a child with a nosebleed also appears very pale and ill and demonstrates significantly enlarged lymph nodes or an enlarged liver or spleen. Platelet dysfunction from medications like aspirin or non-steroidal anti-inflammatories should be considered in a case of epistaxis, and certainly patients who have primary coagulation defects can present with long-standing histories of nosebleeds. Oftentimes, the family history is important here. In one study, up to a third of children with repeated nosebleeds had a diagnosable coagulopathy. Among these diseases are von Willebrand's disease and, less commonly, hemophilia.
There are also conditions in which the blood vessels and cells have an inherent abnormality. One condition, Osler-Weber-Randus disease, also known as hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia, can also be associated with GI bleeding and pulmonary malformations. One of my best friend's family suffers from this condition, and you guys may remember in a previous episode we mentioned big mistakes in our lives, in our medical lives. This is one where I completely missed the boat on. My friend's daughter continued to bleed excessively from her nose, and I knew that they had this underlying condition. And unfortunately, the poor girl's hemoglobin went down to about 5, which is, roughly half of what it's supposed to be. And basically, I sucked. I was awful.
And we
I've been forgiven,
suck.
Apparently, yes. And, a big mistake on my part.
And a good doctor has to admit, a good doctor says, yes, sometimes I sucked. I mean, and we learn.
Even Rob says that sometimes.
Oh, I say a lot. And, so, Matt, says it about me a lot. So between the two of us, it's good.
Right. But HHT, or hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia, is an autosomal dominant disorder of blood vessel walls. And more than 90% of patients with this have recurrent, progressively worsening nosebleeds. It should be mentioned that isolated hypertension has never had a clear association with nosebleeds in children, except as it pertains to renal failure.
But as we said, we always check a blood pressure if the chief complaint is nosebleeds.
Smart. With recurring or excessive nosebleeds, one must consider some lab work. This would include a complete blood count, or a CBC, which can reveal anemia from excessive blood loss, a low platelet count from some type of thrombocytopenia, or even leukemia in a child who is pale, feverish, or otherwise appears quite ill. Coagulation studies like a PT and a PTT, which is a prothrombin time and a partial thromboplastin time, can be useful screening tests for bleeding disorders, particularly for von Willebrand's disease.
And if significant worry about the bleeding occurs, you should get the von Willebrand's panel at the time. If there's going to find something, that's one of the more common things you're going to find. Imaging studies of children with nosebleeds are rarely needed unless there's concern about an associated fracture or other facial bones in the context of trauma. Now, if there's a mass suspected, a CT scan could be considered, or more likely an MRI because it's much less radiation. Either way, when you're getting imaging studies in these cases, you probably want to get an ENT involved. After the break, we will be back with nosebleed treatments.
Ink, a dink-a-doo, a dink-a-dee, a-dink-a-doo. Oh, what a tune, what a tune for crooning. Ink, a-dink-a-doo, a-dink-a-dee, a-dink-a-doo. It's got the whole world spooning.
We are back. I like to think one of the main responsibilities of us pediatric caregivers is to advocate for children whenever and wherever possible. In that vein, I need to take a few minutes to talk about the movement to legalize recreational marijuana. Now, this issue is a complex one. The fact that marijuana or cannabis was labeled a Schedule I drug like heroin by the government in the Nixon administration is beyond ridiculous. And I'm all for medical marijuana and exploring possible medical applications in adults and children, as well as the decriminalization of pot, all of which have been embraced in many states, including Delaware. But legalizing recreational marijuana for adults is a terrible, terrible, terrible idea, especially for our youth. Yes, it's true that many high school and college-age kids already use pot a lot, but this will only get exponentially worse if it's legalized for adults. Recreational pot with pot stores on many corners will just lead to more pot, which means more pot, which means, yes, more pot. More pot in all the high schools, more pot in all the colleges, more pot in middle school even, and elementary schools, especially the edibles, and more in homes with young people of all ages. Just this week, Matt, in Radnor High School on the main line that you like to tease and make fun of a lot, a whole group of high school kids ended up in the Bryn Mawr ER, sickened by pot brownies. Legalization of pot will just make this way more common. Now, Delaware is moving to legalizing pot. The major House sponsor of pot, Representative Keeley, gushed at a governor's public meeting earlier this year that she hoped Delaware could become a major U.S. East Coast pot tourist destination.
Come for the pot, stay for the beaches.
And the pizza. The likely winner of the governorship of New Jersey, Matt, has pledged to sign a bill legalizing pot within the first 100 days of taking office. And Pennsylvania will surely try to join this race to the bottom. It's frightening.
Yeah, I always tell my kids that when they ask me why something is the way it is, I say, follow the money.
Yeah.
It's all about the money here.
Absolutely. And I've participated in some open meetings about possibly legalizing pot locally and in Dover, in our state capital. And the pro-legalized pot group is very organized with paid lobbyists, many vocal proponents. They all have great marijuana lapel things and green ties. The one common denominator of almost all of them is that they have a financial stake in legalizing pot. It's all about the money. Those of us opposing these forces of pot have no financial stake. Addiction counselors, pastors, state police, and the Automobile Association of America, and a few pediatric caregivers. The silent majority of citizens are busy with their families, but their lives will be seriously worsened if pot is legalized. Now, I don't know if you ask about pot to your patients, Matt, but I started to when I talk about drugs and I ask their opinion and tell them that Delaware may become legal. And just about everyone, I think maybe one person wasn't sure, but everyone else, parents, grandparents, guardians, do not support the legalization of recreational pot.
Yeah, we certainly talk about marijuana as we're interviewing teenagers, but I have yet to take a poll of the adults. Maybe that's the more pertinent way to go.
I just think it's good, since they're citizens, just to point out that it may become legalized. And they're always like, really? So it's good to educate them about that, whatever side they take on legalizing marijuana. So, Matt, here are some facts about marijuana with over 23 references backing them up. And you can get all those references on podcastpediatricians.com. All right, marijuana is addictive, especially in cannabis-naive young brains. Just like in opiate-naive young brains, using an opiate's addictive, and that's why we're moving to not giving narcotics routinely for aches and pains in kids. But marijuana drug is the same kind of mechanism, and in these young brains, marijuana use can cause psychosis and increased rates of depression, anxiety, commission of crimes, and later illicit drug use. It actually can change the way young brains grow, as seen on imaging scans, as seen on MRIs.
Yeah, it's hard to argue with a good good functional MRI, because that's hard science. You know, this is your brain on pot.
It's literally black and white.
Yeah.
But structural changes, not just functional, structural changes.
That's scary.
Adolescent marijuana use clearly causes overall poorer life outcomes due to academic underachievement from decreased working memory, permanent loss of IQ points, and overall apathy with a reduced drive to succeed. I call some of those the potheads. Do you see some potheads? Or even back in your youth?
Oh, in my youth, I certainly did. I mean, there was an entire kind of subculture in my high school, as probably in most high schools.
We used to have smoking lounges back then.
Yeah, there was a smoking patio. Kind of like all we straight kids kind of had to walk through. It was like running the gauntlet. The downside was, unfortunately, a lot of those kids listened to really good music that I ignored until later in life.
Exactly. So. And then, and also, we mentioned it already, is Cheech and Chong.
Yeah.
I have two of his albums. I love Cheech and Chong.
Yeah, I made a firm stance and stayed, you know, on the side of probably bands that were still involved with drugs without me knowing it, against the bands who were clearly, you know, more advocates of that kind of a lifestyle, and missed out on a lot of good music.
We both love some of the classic rock and the Beatles. They really weren't into drugs until Bob Dylan came in with a huge amount of pot in the early 60s, and that kind of got them started.
So anyway.
And speaking of Bob Dylan, when Bruce Springsteen first started coming up and the record executives first heard him, all of them said, oh, he's the new Bob Dylan.
But without the drugs.
And he could sing marginally better than Bob Dylan.
Much better. We'll cover this topic later.
Yes, I see potheads, and to be clear, it's not as if everybody young person who tries pot becomes a pothead. And if we could magically create a law that the only people who would use pot were over 22, I could live with that.
You could get behind.
But it just can't happen. And if you make it recreational, it'll be everywhere. If you could maybe have pot centers where you showed an ID, you're over 22, you didn't bring it out and used it there. Opium dens for pot.
Yeah, like opium dens.
You know, I could live with that. You're adult, you make your choices, but that just in real life can't happen.
Yeah, I mean, just like the abundance of alcohol has led to an abundance of alcoholism, you know, even though everybody who drinks alcohol is not an alcoholic.
Exactly.
An abundance of marijuana is certainly going to lead to people who make it the center of their lives. And, you know, I certainly have had patients who that has been the case as they're in high school and college, wherein most of their day revolves around when and how they're going to get their weed, and then, you know, then smoking it and kind of just hazing off into the sunset. And really without a heck of a lot of good that comes from it. In fact, I can't think of any except for just, you know, kind of whiling away the hours.
I point out to them again that you don't socialize as much, you scrape by, your grades get lower, but the one thing that sometimes connects is that they're much more likely to be living with their parents when they're in their 30s, when they get into heavy pot use.
Alone.
Yeah. Oh, exactly. In the basement. Uh-huh. The experiment of legalized recreational pot is well underway in our country, and the longest experience is in Colorado. They just celebrated their 5-year anniversary of legalized pot, and the results are ugly. Colorado, with the legal age of marijuana is 21 and above, has the highest under 21 rates of youth and college age marijuana use and addiction, plus a surge in traffic deaths, which is always the number one killer of teens. The issue of driving while high is a huge problem in states where it's legal and hard to document it. But known drivers high on marijuana involved in fatal crashes has at least doubled, according to the pro-legalization sources. There's also been a surge in Black and Latino youth marijuana arrests since legalization. The argument that's a social justice issue, that minorities are being locked up due to marijuana infractions, is just untrue. The marijuana illegal sales black market in these states just gets bigger with pot legalization. That's one reason why almost all police are against legalization. And not to mention, in these states, the rising ingestion of marijuana edibles by children and even infants. It's a huge issue, And good luck childproofing that pot brownie that you have in the house. As pointed out in the Colorado Spring Gazette this week, the streets and neighborhoods there reek of pot. It really smells. And the homelessness rates have skyrocketed since legalization. And drug violations in K through 12 school children have risen 45% in Colorado in the last 4 years, while all other violations have fallen. And Colorado high school drug violations are up 71% since pot legalization. The argument that pot is safer than alcohol, so it should be legalized, is a specious one. Alcohol is very harmful, but it's a legal drug for adults, and it's been that way in human civilization since biblical times. It helps no one, especially our youth, to then make another drug legal, to add pot to an existing legal.
Yeah, this has always been a struggle for me as I think about the legalization of marijuana, because as someone who casually uses alcohol, I recognize the fact that it is indeed, in many cases, a toxin, a poison, and addictive. But it's also been legal, as Rob points out, for perpetuity. So that ship has already sailed. However, in the case of marijuana, in most states, it's at this point not legal for recreational use. And if there's any way that we can mitigate its use, it hopefully will prevent some of the same heartache that's come from the legalization of alcohol.
Right. And comparing legalizing pot to overturning prohibition of alcohol is a silly one. The lesson of prohibition, to me, is that once you make something legal and acceptable, once you open that Pandora's box, it's hard to undo the damage and turn back. Legalizing recreational pot will be very hard to reverse. And I think the pot proponents are counting on that. Also, teens and college-age kids inevitably look for a bigger and stronger high, and they use techniques such as dabbing. Have you heard about dabbing?
That's that guy in Harry Potter, right? With the long nose and the big ears?
Dobby.
Dobby.
Don't make Harry Potter references. Dobby. You're just over your head.
Stay out of that.
Stick to Bruce Springsteen. So what dabbing is that they heat cannabis oil to a waxy form and then they inhale it. And this often leads to acute psychosis, passing out. Many more kids are showing up in ERs from acute marijuana intoxication using this technique. The mistaken notion that marijuana is harmless just grows and grows when you legalize it. And then this will be perpetuated in our youth for generations and generations. We pediatric caregivers also see marijuana use disorders in our offices, causing shattered families and the wasting of potential of many bright young Delawareans, Pennsylvanians, and yes, Matt, New Jerseyans, in really every state and territory in the United States. Again, legalization will mean more pot, and more pot means more pot means more pot for our kids.
Yeah, I think it's wise, going back to the follow the money mindset, that we can certainly follow the money in terms of the industry's gleaning of money from this product. But what oftentimes isn't mentioned is the fact that this costs society an amazing amount of money from the standpoint of drug usage, drug overusage, drug counseling, homelessness, as we pointed out, and all the other economic downsides to this. Increasing in policing, which will inevitably be necessary to help to control the increased illegal use of marijuana. This is not a topic without a deficit to be looked at, I think, through the same clear glasses as people seem to be looking at the profit from it.
So please do not let lawmakers experiment on our kids. They should be looking out for the interests of our children and do the right thing. Anyone listening who agrees, contact your representatives and speak out. Okay, Matt, back to nosebleeds.
That's laying around the house, up his nose it goes. He started out small, first it was maybe a piece of rice, a bean, a jujube. Then he got bigger and bigger, a walnut, a peanut. Then he started on change, first it was a penny, a nickel, a quarter, half dollar, silver dollars. He's got four knocks up his nose, listen!
Well, that is rather musical. Perhaps you can use him as a maraca.
Listen, doctor, jokes I don't...
So, what the heck do you do about a nosebleed? Well, this largely depends on the severity, timing, and history. Management of nosebleeds can be broken up into three major steps. The first step, initial treatment is generally done at home. Oftentimes, this is done with a pediatrician or other pediatric caregiver on the other end of the phone. This is the basic first aid part. Many parents and even many healthcare providers are not familiar with the proper spot to apply pressure to the nose to stop a nosebleed. Knowing this spot is absolutely critical to one's success in stopping the nosebleed. With thumb and index finger, a pinching pressure needs to be applied directly over Kesselbach's plexus, which is located right where the nose goes from being bony to cartilaginous, or wobbly. This is key.
Key.
Let me say it again. This is key. Many people are taught to pinch the nostrils shut. All this will do is create a dam of blood, which will then flow back into the a person's throat and choke them.
Right, so big take-home points. Head goes forwards, not backwards, and you pinch the cartilaginous part. If you just pinch the bony part, you're doing nothing. I often will have older kids gently blow their nose in the beginning just to get some of the blood out before they start pinching the nose. And once you apply that pressure, again, to that cartilage area, it needs to be held for 5 and preferably 10 minutes, which is a really long time to hold your nose. The child should be, again, sitting up with her head slightly forward. It decreases the possibility of blood dripping back into the throat and being swallowed, which can lead to nausea, choking, even hematemesis, which is vomiting of blood. They can also take their own hand, or a parent can use their finger and press it over the upper lip, kind of like a mustache, while they're pinching the nose to decrease the blood flow.
Yes, and another aspect of this is that one should absolutely be sitting up as opposed to lying down. You know, it's our penchant really to lie down whenever things aren't going well or we don't feel well or something bad is happening. This is a situation where you want to sit up to decrease the blood flow to the head. In more controlled situations, like a physician's office or emergency rooms, the examination and treatment can be more specific. The nose may be examined with a light source. If interior bleeding has not been stopped with the application of pressure over a period of time, then several other options are available. The use of topical vasoconstrictors like oxymetazoline, phenylephrine, or epinephrine at a 1 to 1,000 dilution by a cotton pledgelet can shrink the soft tissue inside the nostril, which is the nasal mucosa, and improve the ability to see the source of bleeding. These vasoconstrictors may also slow down or stop the bleeding.
Oxymetazoline is what's in Efrin, which we don't like because you can get rhinitis medicamentosa when you use it over and over again. It can cause all kinds of problems, but I have seen some ENTs use this on some gauze or cotton and put it in there just to transiently stop the bleeding so they can take a look around. Do you ever use that in the office?
I don't use it in the office, but every once in a while, if I have sophisticated and responsible parents and they're having a tough time at home with somebody who has suffered from recurrent nosebleeds, just before I send them to the emergency room, I suggest that perhaps they try a squirt of this and see what happens.
That makes sense.
There's also the option to chemically cauterize the bleeding site. This is generally done in an ENT's office or in an emergency room. Do you do this in your office, Rob?
Rarely. I think like 10 years ago, I once did it in a child who had had it done before, medically sophisticated parents, and I used the same cauterization silver nitrate sticks that I used to cauterize an umbilical granuloma, and it worked, and it didn't seem to be too uncomfortable, but it's not something I'm comfortable doing routinely. I'd rather leave that to the ENT. A final option to stop bleeding is nasal packing, which I have never done. Have you done that?
No, I've taken it out once or twice, but I've never actually put it in.
This may be necessary if interior bleeding continues despite the use of pressure or cautery. This stops the bleeding with pressure from inside the nose. The sensation can be quite uncomfortable, and the packing needs to be removed within 2 or 3 days. Removing the packing can cause more injury, and any packing used in this situation needs to be coated with an antibiotic ointment in order to prevent toxic shock syndrome. It is also common practice to prescribe prophylactic antibiotics for patients with nasal packing. And again, we would leave this to the experts. Obviously, anything too tight can cause breakdown of the septum and other problems.
The second phase is considered once the acute bleeding has been stopped. At that point, the provider should look for any predisposing factors or causes and put strategies into place to prevent recurrences, if possible. So this would include things like treating allergic rhinitis effectively or treating a sinus infection if it's suspected to be present. The last phase would be management of recurring nosebleeds. In this instance, creating a more moist environment within the nose is the way to go. If one's environment is very dry, or drier than your nose likes it, humidity and nasal saline spray, drops, or gel can be very helpful. We will also commonly suggest coating the inside of the nostrils, particularly near Kesselbach's plexus, which is another good reason to know where it is and to show your patients and their parents. Coat that frequently, and especially prior to bedtime.
Absolutely. That's the most important part. We're all about prevention, and I like to tell them to do it twice a day. And if they do it once, that's you know, okay, but I encourage them to do it twice a day. I use Vaseline. Sometimes if it's significant issues there, I start out with generic Bactroban or Mupirocin to put in an area. What do you use?
You know, I'll use that, although I always have a hesitancy to overuse that because there are situations where we use that, particularly if we're trying to rid a family of MRSA. But I don't really want to create a bacterial environment where things are resistant to Bactroban. I try to stick to the Vaseline or something similar.
Agree. Nasal saline, gentle, nasal gels.
Air gel. Yeah. AYR, I think.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And the environment, again, with the humidifier, moist. And tell them not to pick their nose. So when
You know what we didn't talk about?
What?
Suggesting to parents that they trim back their younger kids' fingernails.
Yes.
Yeah, this is key because it's harder to traumatize the inside of your nose when you have short nails.
Right.
So oftentimes, especially with the recurrent situations with the nosebleeds, we'll look at a child's fingernails and say like, hey, listen, you know, it's probably a good idea to take these back as far as is safely possible so your child doesn't self-traumatize.
Yes, and you know, practicing what you preach, Matt keeps his fingernails really short. So when is it time to refer to a specialist? A pediatrician should consider referring to an ENT, otolaryngologist, urgently if the bleeding is severe or if the source can't be located. Also, if the source is posterior, again, another whole ball of wax, or if the bleeding is excessively recurrent.
A pediatrician should consider referring to a hematologist if coagulation labs are unusual or abnormal, or if there is a family history of coagulopathy, or if there is bleeding from more than one site, or if the bleeding has been so excessive that the child needs a blood transfusion. What blood type are you, Rob?
Don't know why you need to know that, but A positive.
Good to know. Me too. Just in case I need a transfusion at some point, because as our listeners know, we put not only our blood, but our sweat and our tears into making these podcasts. So if you like what we're doing, just tell a friend about this podcast. We can be found on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, TunedIn, and now also on YouTube.
And check out and join podcastpediatricians.com and like us on Facebook.
Good night, Rob.
Good night, Mrs. Calabash, wherever you are. Ha-cha-cha-cha.
What goes up must come down. To go round talking about your troubles, it's a crying sin. Ride a painted pony, let the spinning wheel spin.
Podcast Pediatricians Productions. All rights reserved.